lot of times I get up here and I speak from that which I have learned or that which I have read about, and I teach and I preach the Word of God the best of my ability as to what I understand. This morning I want to tell you that I'm speaking from experience, that I'm an expert on the subject at hand. I am an authority on disobedience. I believe that I know more about disobedience and doing that which is wrong and not doing that which is right more than anyone else. Now, why do I say that? Because a lot of times I've listened to preachers talk about sin and disobedience and not doing what we know to do, and I get the impression that they are lording it over people, that they are telling people that they have arrived at spiritual perfection and that they are an example in which they should follow, and that everyone else is subordinate to them. I want you to tell you that that's not the case here. I am an expert at sin. I am an authority on disobedience. If a light is about to turn red, I go faster through. Okay? If I come up to a stop sign, I go as you want to say, fast or as slow as possible without obeying completely what is commanded. And yet the Bible tells me that is sin. Sin is something that every single one of us deal with on a very regular basis. Most of us ignore it. Most of us hide it. Most of us do not want anyone else to know about it, and we tuck it away and we keep it very quiet. But this morning I want you to know that there's another, what I would call, sin that is less described and less spoke of than all the others. It's the subject of not doing what I know that I'm supposed to do. That also is sin. The Bible verse that we have said over and over and over again, it's one of those sets of commands or sets of principles. It deals with this thing of disobedience. It is to him that knows to do good and doesn't do it, it is sin. You see, as long as we're on this side of glory, we're going to be dealing with this idea of sin. We're never going to escape it. And although I had a friend that came to me one day and said, "Don, I have now gotten to the point in my life where I no longer sin." And he was so serious. And he was so sincere. And I looked at him and I said, "I feel so sorry for you." And he was somewhat taken back as to why I would feel sorry for him, because he felt like that he had gotten to the point where, it should be congratulated. That somehow that we should put a medal on his lapel, or somehow that we should elevate him or put a star on his crown or something. That's what he expected. But rather, I said, "I feel sorry for you." In his mind, I'm now living a perfect life. I have no dealings with all the sin. I am so perfect in every way. How could you possibly feel sorry for me? I simply said, "Because I sin every single day. I sin every single day. And I ask God to forgive me on a regular basis. So that every single time God forgives me, I experience once again the grace and mercy of Almighty God." Those who know to do good and do not do it will give an account, just as those who stand opposed to the very standard of God. Examples of disobedience are threaded throughout the Bible. One of the very first God's word deals with this idea of disobedience. We have very little information of what took place in Adam and Eve's life prior to what we call the fall. But we have a great deal of information of what took place after the fall, don't we? And in the very first story of the Bible, we see that Adam and Eve were given a command of what they were supposed to do, and Eve did just exactly what she was not supposed to do. She committed sin. Now that story of sin carries over into their family life, where one of their children actually commits murder against his brother. And that sin, the consequences of being angry, results in another act of disobedience. If you get to the sixth chapter of Genesis, you've walked six chapters into God's Word, and you know what you deal with? The entire world is so filled with sin that God can't stand it any longer. And what does he do? He floods the entire earth, punches the canopy button, and it all explodes from underneath and on top, and the Grand Canyon is formed, and a lot of other formations take place as a result of the flood. And really because of sin. After the fall, and after six chapters in, you would think, okay, we've got this down. I mean, we don't need any more information about this. We've got all that we can handle. But it isn't until a couple more chapters down the way that all of mankind, or a great majority of mankind, decide it's not by faith that you come to God. It's not by believing in God or any of that. What you got to do is you've got to build your own tower. You got to build your own way. And you see, by chapter number 11 of Genesis, just 11 chapters into the book, a lot of chapters in this book, right? 11 chapters into it, you've got all of mankind saying, I don't want to do it God's way, I do it my way. And we build this tower that reaches up into heaven. You know, when I was a kid, you know what I thought? I thought they were building it so big and so tall that it would actually get into heaven. That wasn't what they were doing. They were establishing a worship practice other than a sacrificial system by faith in God alone. Are you getting that? I mean, into chapter 12, God singles out a particular family. Let's stop trying to just do this whole great big thing. Let's zoom in on one group, one family, and then let's let that family be an example to all the rest of the world, to be the preachers, all the rest of the world, to be the testimony to all the rest of the world of who I am and what I am. And so what does God do? He looks down and he finds Abraham, and he chooses Abraham to be his family. And it isn't long before Abraham turns away from God, declares that his wife is his sister. See if you can get away with that, guys. See if you can get away with that one. I don't think so. Do you know what the first word you learn when you're a little kid? You know, think about that. It isn't mom. You think it's mom, especially the moms. They want the mom, the first word. No way. No way. You know what the first word is? No! No! Why is the first word no? Because, you know, we're born with this idea that we're going to go in the opposite direction of what we're supposed to do. It's our very nature. I've told this story before. Simmer's about 3-4 years old. You know, we're living in this thing, you know, and the front yard's beautiful. And I say, you can go everywhere in there, but you can't go out on the street. You know? And so she looks a little step closer, and she looks back at me, and she takes her toe, and she touches the street. What is it about us that we want to get just as close to wrong as we can and still get by? Well, it doesn't matter. It doesn't seem to matter anyway. If we're face to face with God, like Adam and Eve and Abraham, or if we're just reading his word, what he expects of us, there's one thing that's true. And I told you, I'm an this. Maybe you are too. Maybe you're part of my club. But we are prone to wander. It's our very nature to turn aside, to go our own way, to discover the rules of engagement for ourselves. God's righteousness is expressed in His commands and His principles and His values. They're clearly seen in the Bible. They're clearly seen in nature itself. To the person who obeys God's will, what does the Bible say? You know? To the person who obeys God, what does the Bible say about that person? Listen to this verse. Delight yourself in the Lord, and He will give you the desires of your heart. Now, the part of that verse that all of us know is He'll give us the desires of our heart. We got that verse down. I mean, I want God to give me the desires of my heart. Anything I so desire, I want God to give it to me, don't you? And we use God like that. We use prayer like that. We have relationships like that. But it didn't say, we emphasize the part, delight yourself in the Lord. Well, this morning I want you to look at a passage of Scripture. It's found in James, the 4th chapter. It deals with mainly Christians, not unbelievers, not people who turn aside from God, not people who are apostate, not people who, you know, hate God and claim He doesn't exist. No, these are people who go to church. These are people who say, I love the Lord, dear God, with all my heart, with all my soul, mind. There are people who can recite the Lord's Prayer. You know, give us this day our daily bread prayer. They can do that. That's who James is talking about. Look what he says. Now listen! We got a preacher today that's his catchphrase. He says that over and over again. Listen, why? Because people hear, but they don't. They hear, but they don't listen. They don't pay attention. Now listen. You who say, today or tomorrow, we're going to go into this or that city. We're going to spend a year there. We're going to carry out business. And we're going to make money. I want you to know that there's nothing wrong with any of those things. It's just like the Bible says that when Noah was here and there, God told him he's going to flood the earth, and he made the earth. It describes for us the world of Noah's day. You know how it says that they were eating and drinking. There's nothing wrong with eating and drinking. They were eating and drinking. They were marrying. There's nothing wrong with getting married, is there? A couple of us have done that. And they were given in marriage right up until the day that Noah entered into the ark. What's the point of that? They were just living life. They were living life. They were not disobedient, not anything wrong. They were ignoring God. That's what these people are saying. He says, you know, I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to go over here to a certain city. Name a city. I don't care which one. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to go in there and I'm going to start a widget shop. I'm going to start making widgets for people. Make up something that you're going to make that only you can make, and everybody wants whatever it is you make. Okay, and then you build them better than everybody else possibly can, and you're going to buy, and you're going to sell, and you're going to make money. Is there anything wrong with that? No, not at all. Except, look at this. Why do you not even know what's going to happen tomorrow? What is your life? You are a mist that appears for a little while and then vanishes. Instead, here's what you should do. If it is the Lord's will, put God first. If it's God's will, I know a preacher that grew up with this preacher. He wouldn't even go buy a Coke. They wouldn't pray before he drank the Coke. And say, Lord, I thank you for this Coke, and I pray that your will be done in my life this week. That's how committed he was to this day being for God. If it's the Lord's will, we will live, and we'll go to that city, and we'll make, and we'll buy, and we'll sell, and we'll do this.
that.
That's what we should say. Otherwise, what are you doing? You're boasting and you're bragging. And all such boasting is evil. Anyone then who knows the good that he ought to do and doesn't do it, to him he sins. Those who know God are responsible to obey him. Those who know God are responsible to obey him. If you don't know God, you are not responsible for what you do not know. To him who knows the most is going to be, remember, required. Just leaving God out is a sin in itself. Now, how do we do that? How do we leave God out of our lives? It starts, as we said in the Bible verse, we don't give him any room. I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that. Name an example. Not necessarily a sinful habit, not necessarily a bad thing, but you don't include God in it. You don't even say, God, I want you to direct this. I want you to get glory out of it. It's not even that much. You don't even think about God. So to those who know God, they're obviously responsible to obey him. And if they don't obey him, what do we call that? We call that sin. And one of the sins, and the sin that I want to zoom in on this morning more than any other, is just leaving God out. The sin of disregarding rather than the sin of disobeying. I don't even consider what God would have me to do. How do we do that? Let me give you an example from my own personal life. Okay? You ready? I didn't say it was a good example. I said it was an example. Got it? Okay. So, I need to buy a vacuum cleaner. This was the very first purchase that Virginia and I made after we were married. We needed a vacuum cleaner. Now, you want me to clarify this? You want to see the footnote in this? Don needed a vacuum cleaner. Virginia didn't necessarily need a vacuum cleaner, but I needed one. Okay? And so what I did is I started to save and to scrimp and to do for. No, I didn't do that at all. What did I do? I took the MasterCard that had a $500 limit, and I charged $400 and bought a vacuum cleaner so that I could vacuum out my car. You got it? Now, what did I not do? I didn't say, God, do I really need a vacuum cleaner? Because I know the answer to that. You know what the answer would be? Probably not. Probably you could live your life a long time without a vacuum cleaner, Don. And so, okay. Maybe God says, okay, yeah, sure, you can have vacuum cleaner. What you need to do is stop drinking Pepsi for the next 3 months, and that'll be enough money that you can buy your vacuum cleaner. But I didn't do that. What did I do? I did what an expert to sin does. I immediately satisfy whatever it is that I want, and I don't consult anybody. And number one, I don't consult God. Now, this isn't necessarily a lesson on finances or budgeting, but I figure every single one of you will understand that exactly. Leaving God out. The sin of omission. Very rarely that you leave God out without doing something against God. Very few times will you ever leave God out without sinning some way. Now, there was a prophet. It's in the Old Testament. He's a prime example of what I'm talking about. Leaving God out. Not doing what he knows to do, which is right. His name was Jonah. Now, everybody gets all caught up in this guy of getting swallowed by a fish. And everybody gets involved in the fact that whether this is a true story or not. But you know the main point of this story? He didn't want to do what God wanted him to do. He chose to do something besides what he knew he was supposed to do. Now, am I the only one that knows about this? I think not. I think most of us, if we sit here and examine our lives, examine what happened this last week, we can come up with example after example in our own life where we were like Jonah. God told us to do something. God asked us to do something. God commanded us to do something, and we chose not to do it. In Jonah's case, what did he do? He goes down in the opposite direction of Nineveh. He gets into a boat. He goes in the opposite direction of what he's supposed to do. And he suffers the consequences of not doing what he was supposed to do. Those who don't do what they know that they should do find no comfort in the fact that they've not actively sinned against God. Here's what I want to say. Just because you don't do what you're supposed to do doesn't say, hey, you know, I didn't do anything bad. I didn't do anything wrong. Because there's none of us, me, the expert, that are innocent. Every single person on the face of this earth is guilty. There's no way that we make a claim that either we didn't know or we didn't know what we thought was best and we sinned. Jesus gave several illustrations while he was here on this earth. He told stories about people who sinned. Matter of fact, it's one of the ways that I know the Bible is written by someone besides a man, because no man would keep telling all of these bad things about himself and how he got into all of this mess other than God. And in this case, Jesus told some stories about how that we mess up by not doing. There's a story that he said, and I'm going to paraphrase, and I'm going to read it exactly, but it says, there was a man who had two sons. And the man goes to his first son, and he says, hey, I need you to go out into the cornfield, and I need you to harvest the corn. And you know what the son said? No way! Hey, no way I'm doing that. Who do you think I am? One of your servants or something? You go get one of them to do it. I've got a party I'm going to. You know what we call that? We call that disobedience and sin. So he goes to his second son. He says, I need you to go out into the cornfield. I need you to, you know, harvest the corn. And what does he do? He says, got it. No problem. And then what does he do? It's the opposite. He doesn't do what he knows that he is commanded to do. The story of the two sons. One works for his father. The other one does not. The story of the two sons where one says he's going to do it and doesn't do it, and the one that blatantly says he's not going to do it. There's other stories where one of them comes back and says, Father, forgive me, I have sinned. And in all of the stories, the message is that we have sinned against God. In all of the stories, the message is that we have sinned against God. The only solution, the only remedy for any of them is repentance. The son comes to the father, he repents. The prodigal son goes out here, wastes everything. What does he do at the end? He comes back and he repents. In all of the stories of sin, the conclusion is repentance. You know what the last thing that we ever learn? I said the first thing we ever learn is the word no. And the last thing that we ever learn is I'm sorry. we spend our entire life trying to get away with saying no. And the last thing that any of us want to do is to say, I'm wrong. When it all came down to the end of life and things are about to conclude, Jesus gave a story of a group of his people. And they called themselves a church, and they were in a particular city, and they were known by, you know, First Church of. As soon as I say the name, you're going to immediately know the story. They were the Church of Laodicea. That's the name of the group. They believed in Jesus. They knew that Jesus died on the cross for their sins. They knew that he was coming back. I mean, they had it down. But what they didn't do was follow. I'm going to go into this particular city. I'm going to do whatever it is I need to do to make money. Nothing wrong with that. I just need God out. The Church of Laodicea, they weren't like blatantly against God. You know, it's wrong to name something. I don't like naming sin because I might miss yours. But they're not blatantly against God. Not 100% sold out to God. They're sort of like in between. They're trying to be independent. They're trying to be, you know, like, I don't want to offend anybody type people. You follow me? And so what ends up happening is they're not really against God, but they're not really for him either. And the way that the story goes is that Jesus comes to them and he says, you know, I wish you were for me. Because if you were for me, man, I've got rewards coming out the gazoo for you. I wish you were for me. It would be God's will that you'd be for me. But you're not for me. He says, you know what? I even wish you were against me. Because if you were against me, I could just flatten you out. I could just do away with you. Right? But because you're not for me, or you're not against me, you're sort of like lukewarm coffee to me. Anyone here a coffee drinker? There's a few people. You know, if I drive by Starbucks, there must be a lot of people. And they like spending $5, $6 for one of these. That just amazes me. But anyway, there's one characteristic of good coffee. Now, good coffee could be iced coffee. I don't particularly care for it, but it could be, couldn't. Or it could be hot coffee. Personally, on a cold winter day, and every day of my life since I was about 6, you know, and a cup of coffee. Probably the worst thing in the world is to pour a cup of coffee and then set it down on the desk and get sidetracked. And you end up going and turning the sprinklers on and you're sending the trash out. You know, you're doing good things. I mean, they're not bad things. You're not out here, you know, just sinning. And then you come back to your desk and you pick up that cup of coffee and you start to drink out of it and it's not enough. It's not really cold. You know what you do? You spit it back into the cup. And what do you say? You want to repeat it with, what do you say at that point? You go, yuck! Ooh! And you do one or two things. You either throw it away and start over again, or you walk over because you're conservative and you put it in the microwave and you heat it back up and you start all over again. Right? Am I right? Jesus said, I wish you were hot. I wish you were cold. But because you're not hot or cold, you're like lukewarm. And I take a sip and it's just yuck. I don't know about you. I can only really talk about me. I really taste for God. I really want God to enjoy me and me enjoy God. I mean, is that the way to say this? Is that honest? And the way for us to be a sweet-smelling savor, the Bible says, is to be hot. James told us that we should be actively pursuing God's plan and purpose for our life. Go into this city. Make and sell and buy and do whatever. Make money. But make God the center focus of your life. And don't leave Him out. Make Him part of your life. So I get to this point, like I do a lot of times in these sermons, and I say, okay, I agree with everything that I've said. And then nothing I said that's a heretic. There's nothing I've said that's, branding to the wall. Point and say, aha, you're wrong. No, I didn't. Come on, you need to nod, Did I say anything that was just wrong? Okay. So I had a nice little sermon this morning, and we closed the book and we go home. But the problem is that I've got this little initials that I put at this point in the sermon, and I say, okay, yeah, I agree. Now what? James was talking to Christians. James was talking to people who knew about Jesus and accepted and said, their testimony and so on. So here's the question. YBHS, okay, how do I deal with sin? We have a tendency to do with sin the same thing that we do with other hurts. I get a pain. And what do I want to do? Rather than deal with it, I want to nurture it. I got a toenail that hurts. And what do? I bathe it. I play with it. I certainly don't want to go to the doctor and have him cut it out. I don't want to deal with it. What I end up doing with sin is what I do with a lot of other hurts. I slice it and I dice it and I stew on it. And I stir it, and I cook with it, and I stir it, and I cook with it. And I get real good and mad, and it takes a whole lot of emotion, and it's all bottled up in me. And then you come along and you say, how's it going? And I blow your head off. That's how we deal with sin. And you think, what's the matter with him? What did I do? But you didn't do anything. You've heard the story of the kid that kicked the cat. You hear that story? You know about that story? And he gets up that day and he goes to school. And the bus driver doesn't open the door for him at the right time. And he slams into the door when he comes down the steps to get out. He goes into his locker, and the locker doesn't work. And he hits the locker and the principal turns the corner right when he hits the locker. And gets him. You know the story of this? Yeah. And then his whole day is destroyed. And he comes back home and he gets right to the door and he walks up to the door and the cat walks in front of him. What does he do? He kicks the cat. And the cat looks around and says, what did I do? Well, you were here. And a lot of times, that's what we do. That's how we deal when someone kicks our cat and we become the cat. And we sit there and wonder, what did I do? You didn't do anything. You just was in the way of someone who's been storing it all up all day long. And you know what? We do that. I do that. Ever wonder why some people are so negative? Like they walk into the room and lights shut off? You'd be that way too if you stored up every kind of hurt that you ever received and kept it on the inside and didn't do anything with it. Ever wonder why some people are so prejudiced? You would be too if you categorize pain according to gender, or you categorize pain according to accent or color. You ever wonder why some people are so can I say it this way, have a sour disposition. Their milk's been left out too long. And they're clad. You would be too if you spent your whole life away from God and away from everything that is good and right, and you kept storing away all these hurt feelings and you start adding them all up. Jesus said, out of the heart, a mouth speaks. Do you ever wonder why someone says the things that they say? Well, you'd say them too if you kept them all bottled up inside of you. It doesn't have to be that way. We can choose to pick and choose, I suppose, what comes in, for one. Rather than storing up, we can fill up. You can do your best by filling your minds and meditating on that which is true and noble and reputable and authentic, compelling and gracious and best, not the worst, but what is beautiful, not that which is ugly, but that which deserves praise, not to curse, but to rather encourage. Rather than storing up all of our sorrows and all of our sour grapes, we can remain sweet by avoiding being left out too long. If you're harboring hurts, you're being out too long. If you're storing up that which is against you, you're milk that's left out in a warm room too long. If you find yourself touchy or irritable, you've been left out too long. If you in your heart are angry about something, then you're like milk that's been left out overnight. You're souring. How do you deal with it? Well, first of all, God doesn't want you to be angry. God doesn't want you to store up the sin and the bitterness and the rage and the brawling and the slander and all kinds of that. He doesn't want you to have that. And he can help you get rid of it. He created you the way that you are, and he knew that you were going to store up things, and he made a way for you to spill them out. The Lord's able to heal all of your diseases. It's not a trick question. But the disease that each of us deal with is sin. Addicted to bitterness. Angry at who we are and what's turned into our life or turned out of our life. And so how do you dump it out? How do you get rid of it? How do you empty yourself of all this junk? Well, you go to the Maker. And you go to the one who created you. And it's sort of like a refresh button. It's sort of like shut it off and start it over again. And the way that you do that is by praying. You start talking to God, and you start talking to him like he's a real person who's right here next to you, and you say something like, Father, I'm angry. I'm mad. I'm upset. I was hurt. You know, so-and-so said such-and-so, and you tell God about it, and you dump it right then. And then you ask this one thing. Lord, would you take away that pain? Would you take it away from me? Would you allow it just to leave me? And there's a promise that every single person that comes to God and does that, you know what he does? Cleanses. He takes a Clorox wipe to our heart, the refresh button, the reboot. reboot and says, okay, I'm not going to start you all over again, but I'm going to clean up all the little messes. I'm going to fix it all. I'm going to start over again. Between his hand and the wood, there was a list. A long list. This list involved all my mistakes. The list had all my lust, all my pride, all of the lies that I said. On this list was all of those greedy moments, all of the times in which I knew that I was supposed to be doing and I didn't do. It was a list of every one of them. And between his hand and the wood was the list. You know the list. It's a list of my sin and your sin. The list that God made every moment of every day. You know what? In a moment, when I said, God, would you take that away from me? In that moment, the mistakes were covered. The sins are hidden. Those that are on the top are covered by his hands. And those that run down the side of the wood are all covered by his blood. As Jesus opens his hands and allows the nails to be nailed, and the door of heaven is opened so wide, and it all takes place, and you say, Lord, so-and-so said, so-and-so did. Would you help me?